Hi class, welcome to lecture 5.2 on relevant cash flows. So we're not really going to go over all of chapter 12 in your book, we're just going to focus on relevant cash flows, and that's just for some conceptual material. Like, we will go over most of chapter 12 from a math perspective, so you really need to focus on your test guide for this chapter. Now once again, if you will look up at the header above chapter 12 here, you will see that there are four different sections of chapter 12. All I'm asking you to really learn here are the relevant cash flows. There is some information there on types of risk, risk analysis. You can get into sensitivity analysis, which we have some math problems, and I do talk about a little bit in the review for the test guide video, which is 5.3. But for the most part, I'm wanting you really to zone in here on relevant cash flows. Now, what are relevant cash flows? Well, relevant cash flows are the cash flows that should be included in a capital budget analysis only if that project is accepted. And we're really going to focus on the standalone principle here, which allows us really to just focus on these types of cash flows that might be accepted. And we're going to call these cash flows incremental cash flows, okay? And what we're really wanting to do here is figure out whether or not a specific type of cash flow is relevant. So in other words, we're going to ask, will this cash flow occur only if we accept this project? Okay? If that answer is yes, then we're going to include it. If it's no, we're not going to include it. And there might be, you know, it depends or partial. So in those situations, we'll have to make an adjustment. But for the most part, it's going to be a yes or no. Okay, so let's talk about some common types of cash flows. Let's talk about five of the six we're going to talk about here on this slide. The first is going to be sunk cost. And sunk costs are obviously costs that have accrued in the past. And then what's important here, just know that they're going to be independent of whether or not we accept a project. Example could be a marketing cost to see whether or not you want to go forward with a project. Well, that's going to be independent of whether or not you end up actually accepting the project. Perhaps past improvements on property or assets. So anything that's happened in the past that really doesn't have a direct effect on your decision for whether or not you accept this project is going to be referred to as a sunk cost. And so you just forget about those, right? Or at least you can say they're not relevant. Not for the analysis we're going to do in this chapter. Next is opportunity cost. That's the cost of lost options. So for example, if you are a big gamer, what we're going to talk about here is whether or not not how much money you spend playing video games necessarily, but that you are spending all of your time doing that, perhaps, when you could be learning about finance, right? Or you could be studying, get better grades in classes, and or maybe working a job that you know might turn out into be a real career opportunity. So everybody faces opportunity costs. For example, if you're a famous actor, you probably have a lot of opportunity costs if you accept one role, but you first turned down another role, right? So, for example, Kevin Costner once turned down Andy Dufresne in one of my all-time favorite movies, The Shawshank Redemption. Instead, that went to Tim Robbins, and so Kevin Costner really has to be kicking himself because he turned it down to play the mariner in the wonderful, sarcasm-intended movie Waterworld, right? Same thing happened with Will Smith once. He once turned down Neo for The Matrix. That role went to Keanu Reeves instead. And so then Will Smith turned that down to get to be a cowboy in the wonderful movie Wild Wild West. And obviously I was kidding there as well. So, you know, that they obviously have to consider opportunity costs when they, you know, accept a role or a movie project to work on. So, yes, opportunity costs are relevant. Next is changes in net working capital. So sometimes you need some money up front to get a project going. And so you might have to put that money up front, and it kind of goes in with the initial cost. But then you'll get it back, whatever that amount would be, in the last year of the project. So it's relevant as well. Financing costs are never going to be relevant because you're going to use a WACC, so they're already going to be kind of factored in. So think of the, you know, things like interest and dividends and stuff like that. If you counted them here and the problems we're going to be doing, then you're essentially double counting, right? Because you're going to use a WACC or use that information to get the weighted average cost of capital, which we'll talk about for exam 6. But then you'd also be including them here. So we don't want to do that. Taxes are always relevant. That's just a cost you've got to, you know, the cost of doing business, and you have to deal with it, but you want to include it in. So of these first five, No for sunk cost, yes for opportunity cost, yes for changes in net working capital, no for financing cost, and yes for taxes. Another really interesting type of cash flow that we will have is called side effects. And so you could have positive side effects, which means that if you accept this project, could benefit other projects, or negative side effects, which is sometimes referred to as erosion. And that's just going to have a cost in other projects. So, for example, with movies, right? You could have the sequels, right? So, if you have Lord of the Rings 1 and Fellowship of the Ring will eventually lead to the Two Towers and to the Return of the King. And so, all of those kind of built upon themselves. All kinds of movie sequels tend to do this. You see this with the Avengers movies when you broke each one of them up into, the Iron Man and the Hulk and all the other different characters like Captain America and whatnot. And then you ended up making a one movie that had all of them. Then so there were some positive side effects where each one of those movies had a positive side effect on the future ones. But I suppose if you made a sequel that was really bad, then that could pretty much maybe ruin the chance to keep making sequels, right? And so you could also end up having a negative side effect as well. Sometimes you might hear positive side effects also referred to as complements, and negative side effects referred to as substitutes. So negative side effects may sometimes be referred to as erosion or substitutes, and positive side effects may sometimes be referred to as complements. So there you have it. That's really all I wanted you to know for this chapter. And so you see here, I've given you kind of a summary page on the relevant cash flows, and hopefully you'll be able to take this information and then complete the test guide, which is mainly focused on math problems for chapter 12, with a little bit easier understanding of why I'm asking the problems I'm asking. I go into a little bit more detail in some of the explanations and some of the exact examples in that test guide, so hopefully this will just complement the review test guide. This concludes lecture 5.2. If you have any questions, please let me know. Thank you.